Hello, welcome to my course on reinforcement learning. This is our first lecture. In this lecture, I will introduce the basic concepts that will be extensively used in our subsequent lectures, so they are very important. In the first part, I will introduce the concepts using some intuitive examples. In the second part, I will present these concepts in a more formal manner within the framework of the Markov decision processes. First, an example that will be frequently used throughout this course is the grid world example. What is a grid world? It is a world consisting of a grid where a robot moves around. There are different types of grid cells. For instance, some cells are accessible, indicated by white, while others are forbidden, indicated by yellow. Additionally, there are target areas the robot aims to reach. This grid world also has boundaries. This is the boundary. The robot can move left, right, up and down between cells, but cannot move diagonally. Why do we consider such an example? You will find that it is easy to understand and useful for illustration. The task here is to find a good path from the initial location to the target location. For example, starting from one point, the goal is to find an optimal path to the target. This task in the grid world example raises some questions, such as how do we define whether a path is good or bad? This question will be answered when we study optimal policies later. For now, a good path intuitively means that the robot should avoid forbidden areas as much as possible. Unnecessary detours should be avoided, for example, when the goal is to reach the target area, but instead it goes there, then back and forth, wandering around. This should be avoided. Additionally, trying to cross the boundaries, like attempting to move upwards or leftwards beyond the grid, should also be avoided. Using this example, we will introduce the first concept in our course. State. State describes the agent's status with respect to the environment. In the grid world example, state refers to the location, with locations labeled as S1, S2, S3, up to S9. For instance, S1 corresponds to the location on a two-dimensional plane, with x and y coordinates. For more complex problems besides location, the state might also correspond to speed, and if it concerns a robot, it might include acceleration and other types of state information. When all possible states are combined, we obtain the state space. The term space might sound complex at first hearing, but there's no need to feel intimidated. In essence, this space is simply a set. We use the symbol S to represent the state space, which is a collection of all possible states. The curly brackets on both sides indicate a set, which is a common notation. Sometimes we specify the range of I, but if not specified, we can infer the range of I from the context. The next concept, action, is also very basic. What is an action? In each state, there is a series of actions that can be taken. In this example, there are five actions, from A1 to A5. Specifically, A1 is moving up from the current state, A2 is moving right, A3 is moving down, A4 is moving left, and A5 is staying still, which is represented by a circle. When all these actions are combined, we obtain the action space. Like before, this is essentially a set represented by A, which includes all possible actions. It's important to note that the action space is dependent on the state. This means that the action space varies across different states. Therefore, we denote it with a parenthesis SI, indicating that A is a function of SI. The next concept is state transition. What does this mean? It refers to the process where, upon taking an action, the agent moves from one state to another. This process is known as state transition. For example, in state S1, if the action taken is A2, with A1 being moving up, A2 moving right, A3 moving down, A4 moving left, and A5 staying still, the subsequent state would be S2. This process can be represented by an expression where in S1, taking action A2 transitions to S2. Let's consider another example. In S1, taking action A1, which is moving up, leads to the next state being S1 again. Why is that? When attempting to move up from S1, the agent encounters the boundary, like a wall, and is thus bounced back to S1. This illustrates the concept of state transition. State transition actually defines the interaction between the agent and the environment. Can we define this interaction in other ways? Since this is a simulation, a game, we can define the interactions arbitrarily. For example, if the agent moves upwards and hits a wall, it might bounce back or possibly even bounce to the side, ending up in state S4 or even bounce further to state S7. Since it's a game, it's up to us how we define it. However, in reality, it doesn't work like this. For instance, a robot in a specific location may not be able to move to an arbitrary location. Therefore, we cannot define interactions arbitrarily in real-life situations. Next, let's examine the forbidden area more closely. Suppose we are in S5 and take action A2, which is moving right. What would be the next state? There are two cases. The first case is that although the forbidden area is forbidden to enter, it is still accessible, but entering it results in a punishment. So, if I'm in S5 and take action A2, the next state would be S6, meaning I've entered the forbidden area. The second case is that the forbidden area is physically inaccessible, just like being surrounded by walls, making it impossible to enter. In this case, if I'm in S5 and take action A2, I would bounce back to S5. In our course, we consider the first case where the forbidden area is accessible but incurs a punishment. This case is more generalized and challenging compared to the second. Why? Because excluding some states would reduce the number of states, making the policy search easier. If we suppose the forbidden area accessible, it might lead to interesting behaviors. For instance, although entering a forbidden area incurs a punishment, it might provide the shortest path to the target area. Hence, the agent may want to take the risk of entering the forbidden area to reach the target more quickly. This interesting behavior will be discussed later. State transitions can be represented in a table, where each row corresponds to a specific state and each column corresponds to a particular action. For instance, if I am in state S1 and take action A1, which means moving upwards, I would bounce back and the next state would be S1 again. This table defines every possible state action pair. Although it is intuitive, it has limitations. That is because it can only represent deterministic cases where the outcomes of actions are certain. For example, if I am in S1 and take action A1, I might end up in S1, but there's also a possibility of bouncing to S4 or even S7, indicating multiple potential outcomes that this table cannot express. Therefore, a more general approach is to use state transition probabilities. This is the first time we introduce probability into the course. Intuitively, if I am in S1 and take action A2, aiming to move right, the next state is S2. This intuition translates into mathematics through conditional probability. For those unfamiliar with conditional probability, my book offers an introduction to basic probability concepts in the appendix. Don't worry even if you haven't studied it before, as the concept is quite intuitive. For example, if I am currently in S1 and take action A2, what is the probability that I will move to S2? This probability is 1. Similarly, if I am in S1 and take action A2, the probability of moving to any state SI, where I does not equal 2, is 0. This demonstrates how conditional probability can describe state transitions. Although this example is deterministic, conditional probability can also describe stochastic cases. For instance, if there's wind and I attempt to move right from S1 to S2, there might be a 50% chance of ending up in S2 and a 50% chance of being pushed to S5. Thus, we can express these probabilities as P, S2, S1, A2 equals 0.5. The probability of moving to S5 is also equal to 0.5. Therefore, using a conditional probability is more general. Next, we will introduce a very important concept, policy. This is a unique concept in reinforcement learning. A policy tells the agent what actions to take when in a given state. Intuitively, we represent a policy with arrows. As you can see here, there are 9 states. The policy for every state is indicated by an arrow. This is not an arrow, but a circle, indicating staying still without moving. Based on this policy, we can get some paths or trajectories, which we will explain in more detail later. For now, I give an intuitive demonstration. What is a path or a trajectory? If I start from here, the green arrow represents the policy, telling me to move right when I'm in this location. According to the state transition probability, I will next jump here. And then, the policy, indicated by the green arrow, tells me to move downward, Following this direction, I arrive at this state. Subsequently, the policy directs me downward again, leading me to here and then to here. Upon reaching here, the policy tells me to stay still. Therefore, starting from this location, I will follow such a path. If I begin from this state, following the policy, I will end up here. Similarly, starting from this location, according to the policy and state transitions, I will make my way over here, which is quite intuitive. In addition to arrows, we can use a mathematical expression, conditional probability, to describe policies. Typically, pi usually refers to the mathematical constant pi. But in the context of reinforcement learning, pi usually denotes policy. What exactly is pi? It is a conditional probability that determines the likelihood of taking any action in any given state. For instance, for state S1, the probability of taking action A1 is 0, while the probability of taking action A2 is 1. The probabilities for all other actions are 0. The sum of probabilities for all possible actions in a given state must equal 1. This is an example of a policy. Here we have only discussed state S1, but there are states S2 to S9 as well. For every state, there must be a corresponding policy. The scenario mentioned above is deterministic, meaning that in state S1, action A2 is always taken. However, there are also stochastic policies where the outcomes are not certain. For instance, starting from here, the policy has a 0.5 probability of moving right and a 0.5 probability of moving down. As a result, the actual action could vary, leading to different paths like this and this. Representing this using conditional probabilities is straightforward. In state S1, the probability of taking action A2 is 0.5, and the probability of taking action A3 is 0.5, with the sum of these probabilities equal to 1. Naturally, the probabilities of all other actions are 0 and are often omitted. As we know, every action has a probability, even if that probability is 0. This policy can also be expressed in a tabular form, where each row corresponds to a state and each column corresponds to an action. For example, let's consider state S5, where the probability of taking the action to move down is 1. Thus, for S5, the policy is deterministic. However, for S1, there is a 0.5 probability for action A2 and a 0.5 probability for action A3. So the policy for S1 is stochastic. This tabular representation is very general and can describe both deterministic and stochastic policies. In programming, we typically represent such policies using arrays or matrices. Furthermore, I'll explain how policies are executed in practice. If there is a 0.5 probability for taking action A2 and a 0.5 probability for taking action A3, how is this implemented in programming? The process is quite simple. We can do a random sampling from 0 to 1 using a uniform distribution. If the sampled value x falls between 0 and 0.5, then action A2 is taken. If x is between 0.5 and 1, then action A3 is taken. This is the basic idea.